When applying Fourier transform, you may encounter a certain type of integrals when you try to transform back a quotient of a sine or cosine and some polynomial. Well, how can you compute such an integral? You cannot find an antiderivative. Again, complex variables come to aid, as we will see in this video, we will encounter an explicit example of such an integral. So, we want to compute the integral x times sine x over x squared plus 4x plus 20. And we want to use complex variables. Well, before starting out by drawing just some contour, you have to step back first and think about what would happen if I would just put z, so x times e to the power, x times sine z. Sine is bounded, right? Well, not as a function of a complex variable. So, the real sine x is bounded, but the sine of z will blow up. So, if you would use as a function something with sine z, okay, you can take your contour along the real axis, that part is fine, but then you need to close your contour. And if you would close, for example, on the upper half plane, your sine of z would blow up there. So, that won't work. So, you have to come up with some other function. And then, we often use the following idea. We know that order formula, e to the power x equals cosine x plus I sine x. So we can replace our integral by the imaginary part of x times e to the power ix like this, because the imaginary part of e to the power ix equals sine x. And then in the later step we will use as a function e to the power iz. And this e to the power iz function behaves better, at least in the upper half plane. Think a bit about it. If you substitute z equals x plus iy, your e to the power iz becomes e to the power ix times e to the power minus y. And in the upper half plane, the e to the power minus I becomes very, very small. So that's why this function is much better behaved if your e to the power iz will vanish on this upper ring later on. But this is something you always need to do if you start to do contour integration. Think ahead, plan ahead. If you take a function and a contour, think ahead whether this contour will work at all. And, well, if you take this function over here, like this, well, we're reasonably sure that that we will be able to solve our problem. Let's take a look. So, what function do we take? Of course, f of z now equals z times e to the power iz divided by z squared plus 4 times z plus 20. And also our contour, well, we want to include the real axis because we want to integrate from minus infinity to infinity. And we just argued why we have to close it in the upper half plane. So, there we have our contour consisting of CR, the semicircle, and LR on the real axis, where R is at this moment big but finite. So big number, which is big enough. So that's our first step. That's always the hardest step. Think of what function to use, think of what contour to use, and already plan ahead whether this is going to work at all. On to the second step. Try to apply the theorem of residues. Well, our f of z is a quotient of two analytic functions. Z e to the power iz is analytic, and z squared plus 4z plus 20 is analytic. So f of z is analytic, unless you're dividing by zero. So, when are we dividing by zero? Try to solve the equation z squared plus 4z plus 20 equals zero. You can complete the square, and you get z plus 2 squared. That yields z squared plus 4z plus 4, so you have to subtract minus 4. And you keep the plus 20. And if you solve, then you get z plus 2 equals plus or minus 4i. So we have a z plus minus 2 plus 4i and a z minus minus 2 minus 4i. So you see that f of z is everywhere analytic except at those two points. And you see that only z plus is falling within the contour. It's a pole for the one, as you see. So we can apply the theorem of residues. The integral along the total curve, C total, f z dz equals 2 pi I times the residue of z f of z in z plus. So the next step is of course to compute this residue. Fortunately, it's a pole of order 1, so it's standard to compute it. The residue in z plus equals limits f to z plus of f of z times z minus z plus, like we do over here. And you can factorize the numerator in z minus z plus times z minus z minus. So that means that those two terms drop out. And then you can just plug in z plus. So we get our expression here in terms of z plus. Ah, it looks a bit horrible, but if you plug in z plus equals minus 2 plus 4i, then the numerator simplifies a bit to 8i, so that becomes a bit better. We will need the imaginary part later on, so work out the e to the power I times minus 2 plus 4i and e to the power minus 4 and then e to the power minus 2i yields with the Euler formula cosine 2 minus I times sine 2. We know our total integral equals 2 pi I times this residue, so the total integral equals 2 pi I times this part simplifies to e to the power minus 4 times pi over 2. And then work out the product here, minus 1 times cosine 2, and here plus 2 times sine 2 over here. And then minus 1 times minus I sine 2 yields a plus I times sine 2. And finally, 2i times cosine 2 yields a 2 times cosine 2. So, end of step 2, computation of the residue. That's a bit cumbersome maybe in some way, but it's rather straightforward to compute residues like this. On to the third step, the parameterization wherever necessary. Well, the third step is very fast because we only need to parameterize the real axis, so we can just take z equals x, so dz becomes dx, and our integral along LR becomes just integrating from minus R to R fx dx, the one we wanted to have. So that is easy in this case. Then, getting rid of the integral along the upper semicircle. That is a bit annoying. Well, the e to the power I z is bounded, that is fine, but the function behaves like 1 over z. So if you would try an ML estimate, you will get 1 over r times pi r, which does not go to 0. So an ML estimate is not going to work in this case. Fortunately, we will be able to use the lemma of Jordan, which is a bit stronger than an ML estimate in this case. It is when the integral has this particular form. So how are we going to do that? First we set g of z, this function over here, same function but without the e to the power I z. And if we want to apply Jordan, we have to show that g of z goes to 0 on the upper semicircle. So how are we going to do that? Means that we have to estimate g of z first. Okay, the numerator part is fine, it's just will become a norm of z, it's just r, but we still have to estimate the denominator. So the norm of z squared plus 4z plus 20, use triangle inequality, bigger equal than norm of a minus norm of b absolute value. So that's bigger equal than the norm of z squared is just r squared, minus norm of 4z plus 20. And how do you get rid of those absolute values around this? So we have the norm of r squared minus norm of 4z plus 20. Well, we know, again, triangle inequality, norm of 4z plus 20, smaller equal than norm of 4z plus 20, equals 4r plus 20 on the semicircle with radius r. And that's smaller equal than r squared, provided you take r big enough, like 100 or whatever, then the r squared will dominate the 4r plus 20. So that's why you know this r squared is bigger than this 4 z plus 20 on the semicircle, and that is why the norm of r squared minus norm of 4z plus 20 is equal to the r squared minus norm of 4z plus 20. Okay, that's the first step. We are not there yet, but we are getting closer. We also need to estimate our 4z plus 20. Well, norm of 4z plus 20, triangle inequality, smaller equal the norm 4z plus norm of 20 on the semicircle, norm of 4z equals 4r, so we get 4r plus 20. If we combine those two, then we have finally that our r squared minus norm of 4z plus 20 is smaller equal than, is bigger than equal than r squared minus the expression we have over here. So that will become minus 4r plus 20 becomes minus 4r minus 20. Well, finally, there we are. So our g of z is smaller equal than the r squared minus 4r minus 20, and the numerator was just r, so that's fine. And we said this is mr. And then it's straightforward to show that mr goes to zero if r goes to infinity. Well, do whatever you like divide by the highest power, or use the rule of L'Hopital or whatever, so that's fine. Okay, we really needed to do some hard work in this step 4 in order to show that f of z equals g of z times e to the power iz, where g of z goes to zero. Took some effort to show that g of z goes to zero, but now we know that, we can use Jordan and we can get rid of our integral along our upper curve. So, what does the lemma of Jordan tell us? Well, our integral along CR goes to zero for r to infinity if g of z has to be an analytic function outside of some ring where the imaginary part has to be bigger than zero. C of r is a semicircle on the upper half plane with a big radius. Your a has to be bigger than zero. Well, our a equals one in this case, so that's fine. And finally, this is always the hard part. G of z is smaller than some mr going to zero if r goes to infinity. Well, our a is 1, so that's fine. This is what we just did. Then CR is a semicircle on the upper half plane. That part is fine. That's how we chose the contour. And G of z is analytic. Yeah, just take your radius r0 such that your residue is outside of that. So, all set conditions are satisfied. So, if we take r to infinity, our integral along the big arc will go to zero. Step 5, combine everything. Well, the integral along c total f z dz consists of two parts. This is the one we found in step 3, this one we got to zero in step 4, and it's equal to the tuple I times the residue, which we found in step 2. And then combine everything, take the imaginary part, so we get the integral minus r to r of the x times sine x from this part, plus imaginary part along the big arc, and we take the imaginary part here of the right hand side as well, to get this expression over there. And then we take the limits from r to infinity. Well, this right hand side stays the same, of course, because there's no r there. Taking limit r to infinity, well, the integral along CR, the full integral will vanish, so both real and imaginary parts will vanish, so this one vanishes. And we are left with the integral from minus infinity to infinity of our integral over here. We found the PV of our integral, of our real integral, which we wanted to find. So you see, computing integrals like this, there are big exercises, but you always have the same 5 steps which you're doing. Think of function and contour, find poles and residues, parameterize. You always have to do some MR estimate and combine. But most important, think ahead first. Think ahead when you do step 1, because if you make a mistake there, you will get in trouble in step four, for example. So start exercise always like this, always exercises like this with thinking and planning ahead.